And I'll introduce Mayor Allender. So just over 2 years ago, Mayor Allender went to the National League of Cities Conference, came back, and was definitely the key and the impetus for Early Learner Rapid City. And I really always appreciate his remarks on the importance of early learning, why it's critical to our community, and why we need to support this vital system. With that said, go ahead, Mayor Allender.
Thanks, everyone. Appreciate you being here. There is a lot going on, and the weather is the most remarkable to me. I did just come from Roger Gallimore's retirement deal. It was just coming to a conclusion. That was a nice event over there. One of the things I struggle with, and you know, I'm a guy, so I assume if I'm thinking it, everyone's thinking it, because everyone's got to be just like me. But one of the things I've struggled with is, you know, the likelihood of us being successful implementing an early childhood philosophy in our state and in our communities, and then coming down to this, you know, at the end of a long day and sometimes a lot of negative interactions, why are we doing this? Why? You know, it's like it's got to be someone's job, right? But it'd be better if it was someone else's job. And we just don't have that luxury. So as I think about the why, I start to imagine that it's just a little too abstract for many people to get behind. And some of those people, I think, that have difficulty with the abstract are those who have found themselves in influential positions within our local communities and our state and some within our nation. So it's easy to put early childhood into a political box and say, well, this is a liberal issue. Therefore then 50%, that gives 50 or more percent of the people permission not to pay any attention to it. And, you know, and that's really bad. I've always felt fairly good about the city not taking those kind of stances, but the state certainly takes those kind of stances. It makes it difficult to get support of the state. So that just means in my mind that the campaign, that the learning and the education part of it's going to have to be longer, much longer than realistically it should be. And so we think about it falling in some people's ears as abstract, unable, you know, mythological, something that other than real, plus then falling into the conservative or liberal filters, there's just so many roadblocks. And, you know, of all the people in the country that you could persuade into doing something by saying, well, hey, 40 some other states have seen the light and they're moving in this direction. I mean, South Dakota takes pride in that. We're independent, you know, we're not fooled by the liberal media or whatever. And that, you know, I maybe picked up already, I'm just a little sour on that type of rhetoric, because it's so easy. It's a psychological cop-out. And so I keep going back to why. Why are we doing this? Well, I think for me, the why changes from time to time. When I have my granddaughters visiting, the why is one thing. When I see homeless people outside, I think there's maybe a slightly different why. And when I see jail inmates and, you know, see what law enforcement's going through, I think that's really part of the why as well. But on a more subtle plane, I think the one most obvious why in my mind is that we actually had an argument in the city's working session yesterday The working session is really supposed to be the place where the council will review the agenda for the upcoming council meeting. And but it's turned into a mini city council meeting. So one of the items on the agenda was adding a parking manager for the first time ever in Rapid City. We're proposing adding a city position that will be in charge of millions of dollars of taxpayer assets, not only in the operation and maintenance of them, but also in the planning for future use. So it's going to have to be partially data driven. It's going to have to be kind of an inspirational personality who fulfills this role. They're going to have to talk to policymakers and work with our city planning, and have to review traffic flow and business traffic and the whole thing. And the argument that broke out in this working session was that the position was slated to start at too high of a wage. And the rationale proving that it was too high was that it starts out higher than a starting teacher. And that was the argument. And that there are many people, in fact, you can go back and watch the YouTube video of it. In fact, I recommend you do so. Another part of the argument was that there are many people in this town that don't make this much money, and they're going to not be happy about this. So I think that's, in part, that's the subtle why of early childhood efforts that are going on. There are folks out in this community, and in every community really, whose earning potential is so low because of either the cards they were dealt or choices they've made or a combination of both. But at any rate, the end result is their earning potential so low that there seems to be a political will to attack those who are successful and attack the what to try to keep the wages and everything down to the lowest possible common denominator to make everyone happy. I think that is just absurd. And so we have those folks by the hundreds or by the thousands living in our communities. And it's not that they're a harm to anyone else, it's that they're a harm to themselves. And they're a harm to their children, and they're champions at setting low expectations and bringing children up in that environment. And, let's just say with Rapid City's in South Dakota's early childhood efforts, what do we hope is going to happen by 2000 something? We will have full support of the state. If we were to list out these goals, full support of the state, we'll have great community buy-in, we'll have programs available to little kids, we'll reduce the poverty numbers over time. And now we're adding on, years and decades onto this goal. And some of us in the room are going to come and go. We have to hand off our duty to someone else because it's going to take so long. So I'm saying all that to say this. It's very important to avoid the reasons why not and remain focused on the why. And I'll tell you, this year, this summer, we are going to see the homeless numbers in Rapid City increase, those wandering the streets and the panhandling. And in fact, we're working on right now signs to put downtown to let people know it's okay not to give money to a panhandler. And that's going to bring controversy, and there's going to be all this energy wasted on this topic. And however it turns out, no one's going to be better for it. And I have to be honest with you, that's a government standard. That's a standard we in government are willing to accept because it happens a lot. So that's why it's so important to have this connection with the community and have you individuals here that can help keep the fire burning in pursuit of this great overarching goal of better early childhood education and experiences. And it's very frustrating though from my standpoint sometimes to see that there's more willingness to treat a symptom of something today than there is the root. So I want us to keep working on this so we can treat the root and have the earliest possible intervention in all of these cycles that need to be broken. And everything I just said is for the most part indisputable. You couldn't find anybody who would say, no, you're completely wrong about all that. No one's gonna say that because they either have never thought about it before or they know it's at least mostly correct. So the goal to get to the goal has to be involving more people in this process and getting more supporters behind it. And as politicians run for office and as politicians remain in office, you know, we have to be talking in their ear and understanding that, yes, there's a cost to something like early childhood education, but it pales in comparison to the cost of the lack of early childhood education. And if you're a true fiscal conservative, in my opinion, you cannot ignore this benefit over the absolute consequence of doing nothing. So thanks for letting me vent. I want to tell you all that I appreciate all of you sticking with it. And I'm so much looking forward to getting together in person again. Because I think there is a Zoom fatigue. In fact, if I wasn't talking right now, I'd be farting around on my phone looking at a dumb video or something. And that's just a bad habit that that's 2020. I'm blaming it all on that. But anyway, thank you everyone for being here. And for various reasons, I'm gonna hit and run tonight, so I won't stay for the whole thing, but thanks for being here. And reach out anytime you need support or anything I can do that I'm not already doing. I would love the feedback and the opportunity to do more. So thank you.
Great. Thank you, Mayor. Yes, take away for me, avoid reasons why not. Focus on the why. And I think you will see some fires burning when we have our Early Learners South Dakota updates, because we are really moving and shaking. We're getting a lot of stuff done. So thank you.
Awesome.
Okay, before we move into our subcommittee updates, Terry Davis, director at the library, will introduce Amanda. I'm sorry, I'm gonna back up. Kayla, you have your hand up.
Oops. No, I was just clapping for the mayor.
Oh, it was a clap. There you go. All right. So Terry, if you wouldn't mind introducing Amanda.
Sure. Leading into that, I'd like to thank the mayor for kicking this initiative off a couple of years ago, but especially for putting Kelsey in charge of the coordination and facilitation of that. I think the work she put in was so smooth from our perspective that it seemed that, you know, there was nothing to it. But now as we are taking on the facilitation role from her, I'm realizing how much effort and coordination and pulling everything together went into that. So thank you, Kelsey. You will be missed on this team.
Thank you, Terry.
You're welcome. But now that the library has a different role in Early Learner, we've got myself, we've got Allie Albert, and I'm very happy to introduce our new early education librarian, Amanda Heller, who's been with us almost two full weeks now, I think. And Amanda brings with her a wealth of experience with early education and she also has significant experience in working with and building community collaborations. So she's going to be a real asset to the library and to Early Learner. And she's going to step into the role as co-lead of 1.3.
Thank you, Terry. Okay, and welcome, Amanda and Kelsey. I've already told you how much I've shed a tear or two over how much I appreciate everything you did. Okay, subcommittee updates.
Yes.
Next. Yes.
Just, can I jump in here for just a brief moment?
Of course.
This is Richie for the City of Rapid City City Council. I was hoping that the mayor would join in one of his previous conversation, and I'm going to steal a line from the mayor that I'm not an expert politician, but I did stay at a Holiday Inn Express. So I enjoy his pep talks, and usually what he's been doing with the latest ribbon cutting events is looking for people to run for state legislature. We do need some positive thinking people in the state legislature, which we're severely lacking right now. So Mayor, if I can steal the line from you, is that we are looking for good people to get the fortitude and run for something, because we need some good people to run for office at all levels. So thanks for letting me steal that line, Mayor.
Yeah, and I hope everyone's doing that too. I mean, there's about 1 or 2% of us in our communities that are absolutely bonkers. And those are the folks that are drawn to public office and want to take over things like the school board and have taken over part of the legislature. And so there's like 99% of the rest of us here, able-bodied people. So I've resorted to shaming people for not running for office. So if you're in the crowd, you'll hear that from time to time. Thanks, Richie.
Thank you both. Yes, I agree with you. Okay, subcommittee updates. Next slide, please. I co-lead this with Terry Davis. And so as you recall, we have we use the National League of Cities guide community, Early Learner Community Action Guide. And there are 4 blocks, and we are currently on block 1. Block 1 has 5 targets. And so we currently are working with 5 subcommittees. And the first one is 1.1, which is local leaders work together across systems with a focus on early childhood. And it really is an emphasis on work amongst the leaders. Next slide, please. And this you may recognize, this is what we call a progress rating tool. This comes straight from the National League of Cities guide that we use. And there's one for every target or subcommittee. And you can see there's 3 levels on the far left, they're divvied out there. And then on the right, there's check boxes that can guide our work. And so we've been using these tools to help guide each subcommittee's work. I won't bore you with every little detail and the small print that you probably can't read, but what I will tell you is how we have progressed in our 1.1. And so in level 1, back in January of 2020, we were at a 3.5. We've moved ourselves up to a 4, and we are currently working on that last box and identifying community organizations and how they influence families' lives. Level 2, back in January 2020, we were a 2. We've moved ourselves up to a 4. And you can see the box that has half a mark on it lists a few discrete areas. And we have identified one, and we feel like, of course, this is plural, so we want to find at least one or two more. And then at the bottom level, level three, we rated ourselves at a one in January 2020, and we eked our way up to a two, completing that first box. And you see that green arrow I have on the bottom right, equity pilot for early learner. And so I'm going to touch base, I'm going to explain more about that when we get to our early learner South Dakota updates. And that addresses that second box. And the third box is looking at how other communities have worked with memorandums of understanding. Next slide, please. Our accomplishments so far, all of the individuals that are on this subcommittee have given support in their organization to let their team be involved in this work. We created a vision statement. We created a first one pager that can be found on the website. We approved goals. We looked at the three plans, the Rapid City Comprehensive Plan, Cultural Plan, and Downtown Plan, and identified where they overlapped with the National League of Cities guides. Next page. And so where are we going from here? On the left are those three plans again. And what we've done is handed that over to the advisory group, and they're going to keep it tucked away and identify where the overlaps happen in the future, because a lot of them, a majority, are in blocks 2, 3, and 4, but we're only on block 1. So we'll make sure that they get brought up again when we identify those overlaps. And then I mentioned those few discrete areas. One of those discrete areas is the preschool levels of excellence, as you see on the right. This was developed by the school administrators of South Dakota as a way to look at and help preschools assess quality. And that's my update. I'm going to hand it over to Tim, or not Tim, Allie. Sorry.
Yes.
Okay.
So my name is Allie Albert, and I co-lead the 1.2 subcommittee with Tim Raven. He unfortunately is not able to be here tonight, but he sends his regards. So a little bit of background for our 1.2 subcommittee. Last year, we commissioned a community survey to better understand local early learning environment here in Rapid City, as well as to identify gaps and barriers or opportunities related to local early learning. We shared that survey with you last time, if you recall, and the survey generated valuable data on how community members define early learning. It also revealed that schools, libraries, and doctors were the most trusted sources for early learning information for people to acquire that information. So we felt that further clarification was needed from the medical community on how they define early learning and what resources they share with their patients, and how open they would be to working with Early Learners Rapid City to share some of those resources and get those resources out to the community. So we've decided to develop a few focus groups with a variety of medical professional perspectives to answer some of those lines of inquiry. So we are working with Benchmarks Data Labs in order to ensure that a variety of medical professionals contribute their perspective and experience. We're also going to provide facilitation by making all the arrangements necessary for group facilitation. And then findings generated from these focus groups will be shared with all of the stakeholders, hopefully not at the next stakeholder meeting, but hopefully by the fall one. So the goal is to facilitate discussion and activities that will capture how medical providers define early learning and interact with families and early learners, and also what resources they provide or would be interested in providing to parents. And that's where we can kind of step in and help with some of those resources and making those connections. We're going to develop three different focus groups. The focus groups will be a doctor's focus group, a nurse focus groups, and a medical administration focus groups. We are currently looking for people to participate in those focus groups. So if you do know anyone, please send them our way. We'd be very happy about that. So that is what we're currently working on right now. And we can go to the next slide. So I won't go too deep into detail with this, but we've made some progress since last quarterly stakeholders meeting, Tim and I stepped back and we looked at our progress rating tool, and we decided to kind of start over from scratch and see where we were, not only as a subcommittee, but where we had progressed as an entire group, as Early Learners Rapid City. And those focus groups are a doctor's focus group, a nurse focus group, and a medical administration focus group. So from level one, we have moved ourselves up to 3.5. We're a little bit past making progress. We provide spaces at publicly owned buildings, such as the library, in order to engage community needs. And we're currently engaging city and local government departments in the program itself. On level two, we're at about 2.5. We're starting to make progress on it. Let's see. And if we could go to the next slide. And on level three, we're kind of making progress as well. We have identified funds for early childhood services and for these focus groups in order to develop some more of this information and get some more information out. We are also engaging a broad range of community leaders to be champions and advocates for additional financing for these focus groups in order to make them a possibility. So that is what I have for my update. Thank you very much for your time. And I'll hand it over to 1.3.
Thank you, Allie. Thank you very much. And Amanda, I'm looking forward to getting to know you. I am Janessa Bixel. I am the president of South Dakota AUIC, but I also work at the local Early Childhood Enrichment Office, Early Childhood Connections there in Rapid City. So I'm very invested in the work that we're doing. And recently, like Jess mentioned and Terry mentioned earlier, that Keys did step back from this. She has taken that interim position right now, taking over for Roger. And so Amanda will be joining me. And we have actually been working on a lot of stuff too. I feel like we did have some high marks before. I'll get to the assessment tool in just a minute, but just at a glance here, things that we have accomplished since our last quarterly meeting, we actually did a presentation for AAUW sharing the information that Early Learner Rapid City is doing, as well as how that ties into the state work. I only had about maybe 5 to 7 minutes to talk, so it was a very quick information, but then I did share the PowerPoint out so they would have that. We have been sharing social information on social media through the Early Learner South Dakota Facebook page, as well as other Facebook pages, and through other like email lists and things like that we can get out to people. So there's been a lot going on since there has been the limited in-person meetings that we've had, but we're just starting to get back into those in-person meetings. We had our first leadership meeting in person. It was awesome getting to see everyone. So I'm hoping our committees will meet in person soon too. Where we're at right now, we did create a rubric. Thank you to Carol Foster at ECC for putting that rubric together. And now we're working on kind of honing that rubric and feeling out how that's going to work with vetting some local, but also some national websites. Troy with the Journey Museum is letting us kind of use his website as a guinea pig to use our rubric and see how user-friendly it is. We're looking at the, we want to, when we send people or recommend people go to different websites, we want them to be easy to navigate and things like that. And we might even end up being able to give some recommendations to some of the places, especially local places, if there are, if we're hearing different things with usability. We do have a list of websites created. So once we have vetted this rubric, then we'll be able to go through that. And then we'll have that list of websites, and everything's going to be related to some form of early learning. We will have that available through the Early Learner Rapid City website, or Early Learner Rapid City part of the website as well. So, and then where we're going, we are working on getting the early learning signs installed in Rapid City. We have been trying to work with Parks and Rec to see if there's different parks around Rapid City that we could put some of them up in. And then also at the Outdoor Campus West, which I don't know if we added the images to this PowerPoint or not. No, we didn't. Okay. I have images if anybody would like to see them. Certainly reach out to me, but they're essentially signs. They have them out in the Deadwood area right now where they took a community park and have these little, cute little signs that promote early learning. They're kind of prompts for parents or providers if they're on field trips, things like that, to be able to encourage early learning opportunities within the environments that they're in. So that's something that we're working on right now, or kind of where we're going, I guess, right now. And we're kind of partnering too with Early Childhood Connections with the community garden or the Grow Campus garden that is out at Outdoor Campus to see how we can tie this in together. They've been working with Libwell Black Hills with this garden too, and it's just really awesome seeing these organizations come together across the community. Next slide, and I'll talk quickly about our progress rating tool. So I think we were at a 5 the last time too. I actually didn't do a comparison, so Jess, I apologize for that. We have reached the level 5. We feel like we're well on our way on both level 1 and level 2. We've reached number 5 on. And then we're making progress in the third level. We do have a couple of things like partnering with parent leaders. We haven't really targeted that yet. The pandemic has put some challenges in place, but we have some potential leads with that. And then also using a children in all policies or children's first approach to awareness. We do that within the committee work, but looking at the bigger picture from our community, is that happening across the community? So we're looking, those will be some of our next steps to look at. And that's where we're at. Anybody have any questions for 1.3? Okay. And it goes over to Troy.
Good evening, everybody. This is Troy Kilpatrick. Thanks for joining tonight in a quarterly stakeholder meeting. When I think about what our committee's gone through over the last few months, it's been an interesting challenge. Appreciate Allie and all the things she's doing. Kelsey, we miss you though. We went through some detailing, chasing around stuff there in this past quarter. And I think some healthy conversations within our committee in regards to new committee members. I appreciate Amelia being on tonight. And I know Shelley Adams. We asked ourselves a lot of questions over when I go through the rating tool, you'll see that we didn't really move our rating tool along much. And part of that was because I think we were engaging new people and we were reorganizing and asking questions of ourselves. And some of the things that we were really sure of when we scored ourselves last quarter, we became less sure of through the course of this last quarter. But I think that by taking a step back and having those conversations, I'm excited and I'll be optimistic to look forward into the next quarter. That's what this is all about, right? Is that we have to be optimistic. But we scored ourselves as a 3 last year. Our area, rich network of informal supports available to all families. We scored ourselves as a 3 right in the middle a quarter ago, and I left us there at that point because we had described lots of formal and informal network partners potentially, and we'd even kind of created a sheet, and we had ourselves talked into thinking that we had a spreadsheet created that we've later figured out we hadn't built yet, which was part of our stop and go process here. So we decided, well, we'll just start over from scratch, and in the meantime, it'll probably be a better list. But again, all of those things I think are somewhat of a victory in regards to just making sure that we think we know what we're talking about. And I think even as we put this stuff down on paper, there's going to be an opportunity for us to see ways to look at it better and enhance things. Our goal inevitably is to help create a map here of all the formal and informal supporters. And we have connected with the city of Rapid City, a gentleman there who can help us, similar to the food security mapping that was done with Feeding South Dakota. We're going to be able to identify the network of early learner places throughout the community so that families can look at that and find out, well, who's in West Rapid, who's in South, who's in North, who can help me logistically with what we're doing here. So all those things are kind of, they've been kind of done and we're still working on them. So when you switch to our rating tool, I don't know who's driving, but if we look at our rating tool, you'll see that 3 is where we had ourselves before, and those boxes that you can't read is us talking about us describing informal network partners and working on a community map. We had originally scored the second levels there as 1s, as just getting started. The community is rich with opportunities for families to make connections. We moved it a little bit because I think our discussions have illustrated that there's real opportunities here to understand that better, especially within the next quarter. On level 3, mechanisms are in place for all parents and families, especially families who are often more inclined to make connections with each other. Every neighborhood has safe places for people to make connections. Again, we move from 1 to 1.5 because we feel like that mapping is going to be able to drive us to there. Again, we'll just take an optimistic approach. We've added a lot of committee members through the last course of the last few months. And Jess, I think officially there was never a quarterly meeting last year in April. It seems like we got back together at about July because that was about when this committee originally it started, and then we stopped, and then we reorganized in July, August timeline. So I'm pretty sure this is like our 7th quarterly out of the 2 years. But it's kind of an amazing, it's been an amazing adventure here, all of us persevering through Zoom. And I thank all of the other leaders and all of you who are being engaged in this and dedicated enough to kind of see this through when it's such a difficult process. And we're just all making it work as best we can, like tonight on Zoom. So thank you all. I'm going to turn this over to Kayla Klein to update 1.5. Thank you, guys.
Thanks, Troy. And yes, I just want to thank Amanda for joining. Welcome. And thank Kelsey again for everything that she's done. You've been a true asset. I'm going to go through 1.5, and I know that our big accomplishment has been the fact that we created the Rapid City Resource Guide that was specific to resources that revolved around early learning. They involve both for-profit and nonprofit entities. I put the link that takes you directly to that resource into the chat, but as a reminder that you can always find it on the Rapid City community page on the Early Learner South Dakota website. So it's always available there. The first step of the process was making this resource guide. And the second process was, or point of the process was getting it out to people. Of course, as we all know, COVID came along and disrupted those plans just a bit. But we've been working on trying to get this out regardless of being able to personally visit centers and, doctors' clinics and things like that. But now, since that's getting a little bit more lax, we're back to making those plans. How we originally got the word out on this is we put out a press release. We did get coverage from KNBN. We made there's an interactive, again, available on the website. We also did send out to all the committees a email template for folks to send out to their respective email distribution lists. And so that worked, and I know it worked because I got a lot of emails about how to download the document. I think we solved that. We put kind of some simple instructions on the website of how to download the document, so that helped. And now we're working towards creating a simple business card. We're working with Troy's group actually to create a little business card that drives people to this resource page and to the our Rapid City page on the Early Learner South Dakota website in order to just get the information out there. Simple business card that we can give to providers, medical professionals, school districts, you name it. And it's something just easy and quick that parents can pick up and guide them to our website. So this is truly kind of the great way about how the committees work together. Troy and their group is working on distribution of materials. And so they're a part of our business card process with Allie and Tim's work and creating the focus groups. We love the fact that they know who parents trust when they're talking to about early learning needs. Now we kind of know how to market and where to give those business cards to, and their focus groups are going to illuminate even more kind of the direction we have to go. So they all kind of beautifully work together, these subcommittees. So I appreciate that. We'll go into the next slide here. Our group, this is kind of where we fall, where we feel really good about level one, and we're moving our way into level two and three. We spent our last meeting talking about kind of what we've already done in some of these other levels, level two, the middle box, and three, the bottom box there. So we're just going to continue again with kind of getting the information out there. And some of the things we noticed that we've kind of already been doing are those two things in the level three box, encouraging parents and other family members to become ambassadors and spreading the word about services and such. And what I want to share is we're also excited to have Amelia on our group. I know she joined Troy's group and our group. But she is a fantastic asset. She is the new ambassador, if you will, for Early Learners South, SDPB, Early Learning Initiative. And she's going to be starting to go and visit some of those providers. And she's happily said that she would share some of this information when visiting Rapid City providers. So thank you for that, Amelia. So that way we kind of know we already have, we can also have her as our Early Learner Rapid City ambassador. So yes, yay for that. All right, and we'll go on to the next page. I think that may wrap it up for me. Yeah, okay.
Great, thank you, everybody. Those are fantastic updates. And even though I just recently heard them, it gets me excited and fired up, as the mayor said, on the progress that we've made over the past two and a half years, despite COVID. And now that we're getting some semblance of a little bit post-COVID, I'm excited to see how much more we can do. So with that said, I'm looking at our time. We're doing good. We are going to have a breakout session. And the question, as you can see here, that we would like to hear from everybody is, what would you like to see from us as the leadership team in order to understand our progress better? And unless you feel like we're doing an okay job, are there different methods of communication? We do understand. We would love to do more in-person updates and meetings. And however, some people do find Zoom a little more convenient. So those are just some things to talk about. And with that said, go ahead, Janessa.
Okay, yep. So I've got about four breakout rooms, four to five people in each room. And we do have one of our people from the leadership team in each of the rooms to help facilitate the discussion and be able to take notes from those discussions. So if anybody have any questions about breakout rooms, you should be able, I'm going to like wave my magic wand and push the button and poof, send you. You might have to click accept and go into the room. And I will hang out here on the main screen. So if you have any technical issues, I will troubleshoot those with you. All right, here, I have about 6 minutes. So once everybody gets adjusted, that'll leave a good 5 minutes for discussion and then we'll come back after that. 30 seconds to count down when you get the notification that the room is closing. All right, here we go.
Back.
It looks like everyone is back.
Okay. Yeah, you know, we always waver on how much time we have though. We could have kept talking. I don't know about others.
It's like we give more time and then we don't need it and then we take time away and then it's like, oh man, we could have used it. Sorry. Yeah.
I just know I need to connect and have conversations outside of tonight and learn more. Yep, and learn more. So, okay. Next slide. Thank you. And we'll hand it over to, I believe, Vanessa and Kayla. Vanessa? Okay.
Yeah. I'll get us started and then Kayla will finish us up here. So Kayla and I both work really heavily with the Early Learner South Dakota initiative. I inherited it when I stepped into the role of president in 2019. A lot has been happening. It was an initiative with the grant and it kind of culminated at the same time that Early Learner Rapid City was starting. The pandemic threw a big wrench into things and kind of shifted some of our focus. And so we actually are, it's the last thing on the list there, but we are looking at re-evaluating our strategic plan. And actually we've reached out to Benchmark Data Labs with Kelly Schlusner to do that because she has been doing such fantastic work for us. I cannot sing her praises enough. She's just so amazing. So we're looking forward to a strategic planning session with her. We've got a proposal out that's been approved by our board and our budgets and all that good stuff. And then we've had a ton of new changes come about. And I personally feel like the spark really got lit with the public policy forum that Kayla helped lead that initiative on in January and late January, early February, where we partnered with CPCM and put on a state public policy forum, because prior to that, we had two communities on board and now you can see the list there. So I'm gonna turn the control over to Kayla and let her talk more about the toolkit and newsletter and the communities. So thanks, Kayla.
Yeah, thanks, Janessa. I think just from our breakout conversation, I am going to but I think it's just really good. We send out a lot of new what comes through on the newsletter is we talk about what other communities are joining across the state. I really want to reiterate how amazing Rapid City is. I mean, you guys lit this fire that is now spreading across South Dakota. So I really want to reiterate how exciting this is and how excited other communities are. Not only do we have these communities who are listed, but I know that we have a bigger community writing a grant for one, and then another community looking at this process. So we're looking at potentially two more communities joining relatively soon. So this is exciting stuff. And how with Early Learner South Dakota, we help the communities is by creating resources that you might need. For example, we heard from some communities that they wanted a press release template, that they wanted a social media toolkit template. So we at the state level have some grant funds from a national organization. We create the resources and we get them out to you as communities. And I'm talking to you as Early Learner South Dakota because I lead part of that work, but of course I work within the Early Learner Rapid City work as well. So some of those materials I shared a link here. This is our early learning marketing materials page. I always like to remind people to revisit this link because it has all of the materials that we have available. They're already created and literally all we have to do is say, okay, we want those, let's do this. I know even in the leadership group, we tend to come back to it. Terry just mentioned, in one of our leadership meetings, hey, the decals, maybe that would be a great idea. And so it's there for as a collective. If we create something as Rapid City, it goes on there so other communities around South Dakota can use it. So all of these materials are branded Early Learner South Dakota. So all of these materials are being used in these early learning communities. So we're creating brand awareness and this importance of early learning, not only in Rapid City, but across South Dakota. So it's a big deal, you guys. It's cool. It's great. So I just wanted to make sure to reiterate that. So I'm going to add you to the newsletter. I covered that. You will see on the marketing page that there is a social media toolkit, but that was something our Brookings community actually brought up. They said, hey, do you have any pre-generated social media posts that we can share? And of course our team said, no, but we'd love to make some for you. So I put the specific link for the social media toolkit as the next link there. And anyone can use that. If you're a provider, if you're a physician, if you're the school district, if you feel as though you'd like to use those, please do. They have graphics and verbiage that go along together that you can just simply put out there. I keep getting notifications that some group East River is using them. They use our hashtag, and I'll get notifications every week on Facebook that this group East River is using these posts. It's really cool. So feel free to use them as much or as little as you want. That's what they're there for. Janessa mentioned, we are looking at a strategic plan, and I do want to mention something to all of you just in case. I wouldn't want this to get confused. As a reminder, so I'm with United Way. I lead the Black Hills Reads Initiative, and Early Learner South Dakota received a $5,000 grant from us. And so that's how we've been able to fund some of the initiatives, the focus groups, that type of thing. But Early Learner South Dakota is currently applying for a large grant at a national level. That grant would be able to, would allow us to create a policy roadmap for early learning across the state. The entire first year is to essentially help us with a strategic plan for creating a policy roadmap for early learning. And the second year would be looking at implementation of that grant. So that is something we're working on. And in case someone mentions a grant, it is separate. There is a grant that Rapid City is working within through Black Hills Reads. And there is one that we're currently writing at a state level. So again, I think anything that the committees bring up, or if just as a reminder, and I remind the leadership of this too, if you guys are seeing that you're hitting a breaking or like a stopping point, and you're like, hey, we really need X created for us to move forward, please let me know, or Janessa or Jess, like one of us will get you connected to where our state group can help you create those materials and things like that. Something I'll be releasing very soon is some updates with some health, the child care tax credit, some health information, things that are available to children and families in South Dakota right now due to some relief funds. We made a infographic about that. We'll be sending it out to all of you as stakeholders, so you can share it with parents, providers, whomever you feel it would be beneficial for. So I will stop there and just see if anyone has any questions on any of that. Alrighty. Well, thank you so much, Janessa. Hopefully I didn't miss any. Oh, Autumn, I'm sorry. Autumn and Richie, you're off mute. Did you have something? Oh, okay. Oh.
No, sorry.
Okay, no worries. Sorry, this is how I moderate my my work groups on Zoom most of the time. I look for people who come off mute. So sorry, that was a force of habit.
I'm just used to getting muted all the time anyway. So sorry.
No worries. Okay, well, thank you, Janessa or Jess. Feel free to mention anything if I miss something.
Well, I just wanted to tie in. I just think it's an amazing connection with everything that's going on. And then what Biden just presented recently, I'm interested in seeing how that's gonna play out in the upcoming months and how it's gonna tie into the work that we're doing. So we're closely monitoring that situation, and our national partners are making sure that we are aware of facts that are coming down the pipeline in regard to all of that. So thank you everyone for your support, and I'm glad to be a part of this. And Jess, back to you.
And this is just a infographic that ties together what Early Learner South Dakota is, the communities, and then the toolkits that, or the toolkit that is available, again, all available on the website. Next slide. So now I'm going to talk about the equity pilot that we are working on with Early Learner South Dakota. You can see the two documents that are highlighted there are the Equitable Early Care and Education Framework and then the associated rating tool that goes with it. And again, excuse me, they're created by the National League of Cities to help communities assess how they embed equity into their work. And the Early Learner South Dakota leadership recognizes that we've always considered equity in our work, but it's never been formalized. And so when we saw these tools, especially since they're developed by National League of Cities, that we felt this is something that we really should get started on in a more formal fashion. And because Early Learner Rapid City is a community that's been furthest along in use of the National League of Cities guide, that the leadership team got together on April 16th to establish a baseline. Now we dove into this work knowing we have a lot of work to do, but we really needed a baseline. Next slide. And so this framework is based off of these eight, what they call elements. And I'll just quickly read them off, but starting at the top, multi-sector partnerships, data-driven decisions, family engagement, equitable access, coordinated continuum, professional development and support, sustainable resources, and community participation. And so what we had to do is with each one of these elements, rate ourselves from 1 to 5. 1 being no work at all, 5 like we've got it mastered. And with each element, there were 3-7 equity considerations that we needed to score ourselves on. And so we all scored and we got the mean score together. And then we went back and looked at where we had the most disparate answers. Like if I scored a 1 and Janessa scored a 4, that's way different. Why did we do that? And so we went back and looked at, there weren't many of them, but there were some. And what we really learned after this really good discussion is that we most likely defined things differently. And so we had to solidify our definition of what we meant by that particular equity consideration in that element. And so what we found that within these 8 elements, our highest rated is the multi-sector partnerships. And this has a lot to do with leaderships and collaboration. And I think most of you know our community has to be collaborative in nature because we are, and because we don't have as many resources as bigger cities, so we really have to work together to leverage what we have. So we're collaborative in nature anyway, but that was our highest. And then our least rated was the community participation. And so with everything else falling in between, really close between like 30 and 40% points. And so this is what we've learned. We established our baseline. And that's where we're starting. And we anticipate continuing to do this work. I need to do a little more processing and analyzing what we went through before we move to our next steps. But I'm proud of us for getting a start because this is very hard work to discuss equity and how we embed it in everything we do in a formal fashion. I'm going to pause there because next slide is actually closing remarks. Do we have any questions? No, everyone wants to get outside and enjoy the last few minutes. Next slide. I promise I'll make this quick. So again, thank you all of you for your commitment and welcome, Amanda. All of you, if you ever have questions, I hope you know you are always more than welcome to reach out to any of us and would love to have conversations. If you have ideas, very welcome. And I want to go back to what the mayor said, that please avoid reasons why not. I think we as this group, we don't have a problem with that, but encourage others to avoid reasons why not and focus on the why we should. And this work takes a long time. We have a motto that you've probably heard me say before is, we got to go slow to go fast, deliberate and stick with it. And so my charge to all of you is, we are counting on you, every single one of you, to help with community awareness. We all have friends, family, coworkers that probably don't understand this as well as we do, unless you're totally embedded in early learning work like Janessa and Kayla and Autumn and Sunny and, well, all of you actually. So that means friends and relatives and people you run into in the grocery store. Share this information, because that is how we're going to get community awareness, and we're going to get more support. Once we get those cards, hand them a card and say, hey, here's a great resource. Go look at it, learn more. So that's my charge to you. You see some dates listed, next quarterly meetings, Wednesday, July 28th, Monday, October 25th, and they will be in person at the Civic Center at LaCroix Hall C. With that said, again, thank you everyone, and thank you for all of my early learner Rapid City and South Dakota peeps for all the time and energy you put into everything. And I hope you have a wonderful weekend. Take care.
Thank you. Bye.
Thank you.